All right. I'm just going to sit here and turn it over to Nick Nisi, co-founder of Nebraska JS and Beer and Co. Thanks, Nick.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Nick.
No Simpsons fans. I'm Nick Nisi. I'm a software developer at SitePen, and as Sean said, I help out with Nebraska JS and Beer and Co. And today I'm going to talk about testing, front-end testing. So who here has familiarity with front-end testing? Every day? All of you? Yeah? Awesome. Do you do unit tests and functional tests? Just functional? Okay, cool. I'm going to talk about both today. So I'm going to start off by just a quick intro into unit tests. This is an example of a unit test. It's just where we load JavaScript, make assertions against that code, verify that it works, and we're doing this all from the perspective of the developer. We're actually calling the methods, passing them input, and then getting the output and asserting that it's what we actually want. This is the simplest testing framework right here, this single function, and I'm just checking if the actual value is not equal to the expected value. If it's not, then I error with the provided message. Otherwise, I don't do anything and everything is happy. So I have this function to test where I'm going to just square a number that I pass in and return it out. And so I can square it and return it. And this would output nothing because this one would pass. This one, though, 3 squared is 9, not 6. So when I run it, we do see that it just errors out. And that's the simplest one. But we want to build on top of that. We want to make it easier to run the tests in an automated way. Maybe we want different kinds of assertions instead of just checking equality between two. And so that's where a good test framework comes into play. And also for building functional tests. Functional tests are where we actually mimic the user using our application. So it's testing from the perspective of the user. And so with that, we just load a site and then we pretend that we're the user. We drive the browser to do different actions. We click on buttons, we type into text fields, and then we see if our actions on the page generate an expected output in some way, and then we test that. So here's an example of that. We have a login page, and we just find the username, click on it, type in their test for username, and then in the password, it's also test because we're totally safe. And then we find the submit button and click it, and then just, in this case, we're just asserting that we went to a new page that has success as its title, and that means that we successfully logged in. So the tool I'm going to talk about is a tool called Intern. It's a tool that we build at SitePen that allows us to easily create unit and functional tests and run them in multiple environments. So we can use this to write tests for node code, and we can also use it to write front-end code that we can run locally, or we can use cloud services like BrowserStack or Sauce Labs to test those out on the cloud and run browsers that we don't have locally, like Internet Explorer and others. It also gives us things like the ease of writing asynchronous tests. It's all promise-based. It gives us code coverage under the covers. It uses the Istanbul code coverage tool. And then it hooks into continuous integration and everything. It also has this nice wrapper around the WebDriver API called Leadfoot that we'll kind of look at a little bit that shows us how we can easily drive the browsers from JavaScript. So again, just a repeat of unit and functional tests. This is the basic structure of an intern test. With this, is everyone familiar with the AMD style of JavaScript? This is kind of what it is here. We have this define block, and that's where we're bringing in these dependencies. So we're bringing in intern's object dependency. Intern uses the chai assertion library, so we bring in that so that we can make assertions, and then we bring in the code that we actually want to test. And under the covers, this is effectively creating script tags on the page, injecting all of those in there, and once it gets the code, then it executes this callback function with everything, so we don't have to create global variables or manage long lists of script tags on our own. So we created a test, we named it person, and we have a greet function that we're going to test. And so we just want to do a test where if we create a new person and pass in the name Joe to it, and then we say Joe.greet Anna and pass in that as an argument, we want to assert that the greeting is equal to this, where it'll print out, hi Anna, my name is Joe. And we can just test that with the input and get expected output. again, this is a unit test, so it's from the perspective of a developer. We're actually calling the greet method instead of interacting with the page in some way. So when we develop these tests, we have a number of, we have a hierarchy for creating them. We have the test module itself. That's this whole file. The whole file that brings in everything that we need, including the code that we need to test. We have the test suite itself. That's here where we're calling register suite to register a number of, or register a suite in here and giving it a name. So this is the person suite. And then we have test cases. So we have a greet test here. We can have multiple test cases all through that. And then inside of each test case, it makes assertions. And those assertions are what are actually going to do the testing. It's going to, the test case will set up the code, and then the assertion will see that, will ensure that the code is actually running the way that we expect it, or it'll complain and we'll know. So we can make a number of assertions. These are just helpers that will throw an error if the value that's passed in is not what we expect it to be. So we have assert.ok, that's just if something is truthy. So value, a string is truthy, so it'll be, it won't do anything. This one, an empty string, is falsy, so it won't, it'll actually complain about that one. If we actually want to test if it's the value true or false, we can do that. Strict equal is like the triple equals in JavaScript. And not strict equal is the not double equals. Deep equal, we can test objects, compare objects to each other, and we can compare properties on an object as well. And there's lots of other ones. This is chai. It's an assertion library. And you can look at the API docs. It's just chai.js.org, I think. But that's one way we can do it, the assertions. There's also the BDD style that it provides, so we can use the expect or should interface for that. So we can, it's just another way of writing the assertions in a more English language type of way. So we can say, we want to expect that the value, we want to expect that the value to be okay, or we want to expect one to equal one, etc. So it will, it's just, it reads more like plain English if that's the kind of test that you want to write. You can easily do either one. So with unit testing, we just take the code, we load it into the browser or into the environment, run the code, and then verify that it's actually doing what it says. So with this, we can run it in two different ways. We can either load the page up in the browser, and it'll just use that browser's JavaScript engine to run each of the unit tests, so V8 and Chrome and Firefox, etc. And then there's also Intern Client, which allows us to run the tests in Node, so we can just load up Node, execute the test there. The big difference here, though, is it's not using PhantomJS or anything like that under the covers. It's actually running it in Node. So if your code is trying to access the document or window or any of these variables that are browser-specific, it's going to fail right there because that's only for testing code that can run in Node as well. So here's just another example unit test. We're bringing in this hello module. And we're just going to make assertions against it. So we register a new suite. This is the object style test. We can also do the BDD or TDD style, which I'll show in a second. But we can, we're naming the test, and then we're testing the greet method. So we're just going to assert that when I call hello.greet and pass in Murray, that it outputs hello Murray. And if I say hello.greet without anything, then it outputs hello world. And so it just replaces the name with world if we don't provide it. And so when we run that, what I can see, this is the HTML reporter that's being used, and we can see that it's running it, and it just outputs everything here. So we can see that we had four tests. I have them in all of the different styles. How long the test took to run, how many fail, and the success rate. So let me make this fail real quick. So, inside of our tests, here is the BDD style of writing those tests. Can everyone read that code? Okay. So, we're just bringing in app hello, and this time we're bringing in intern BDD. So, instead of saying register suite, we can just describe our tests here. So, it's more English if you want to write your tests like that. So, I can just say describe hello, naming our suite hello. And then I have a sub-suite in here, describe the greet method, and then this is the test. It returns a greeting for the person named in the argument. And then I just expect hello.greetMurray to equal hello.Murray, and expect hello.greet with nothing to equal hello world. So if I were to change this code to actually put in Shauna, it's going to say hello Shauna instead. And that's going to fail because it does not equal hello world. Oops. And so it just pops up and tells us, hey, this test failed. And so you can have this set up to run with a watcher that refreshes the browser every time you save or do other things. And then you can just, if you have this in the background, you can see when things turn red and then go figure it out. So it gives us that quick feedback while we're writing our tests. We can also do asynchronous testing. As JavaScript developers, we have to be pretty familiar with asynchronous code, where we tell it to go do something, but we don't know when it's going to finish, so we have to provide a callback or wrap it in a promise to get that return to us, so that when the code actually does finish, then we can continue on with whatever output we're actually trying to receive. So with that, we can just call this.async, and this will automatically make the test a asynchronous test. And we give it a timeout. This is the number of milliseconds that we want to wait before it eventually times out. And optionally, we can give it a number of calls to resolution. So if this, if it has to call that code multiple times, then we can say that it should only succeed after the third time, when it's actually been run successfully three times, instead of having some kind of countdown. So here's an example asynchronous test. If we had to, for example, go get code from the server, like we had to go get this JSON file, then we could go get that. We'd say path to resource.json. We request it, and then when we get the data back, then when we have the data, we can make our assertions. And Intern will sit and wait until that comes back, or until it, or until the timeout has run. This is the one from the previous slide where we're actually using async. We're saying that wait a maximum of 2 seconds. And then here we're just using set timeout. So after a half second, then we're using deferred.callback, which just tells it to resolve the promise as long as there are no errors thrown inside of here. So that's where we can make our assertions. In here, we didn't use this.async. Instead, we just returned from the promise or from the test. The return value that we're returning is a promise, and Intern just picks up on that, and we'll wait for that promise to resolve. So we used deferred.callback, that's when we want to resolve the promise as long as it doesn't throw an error. And reject on error will not resolve the promise, it will just reject if there are any errors thrown, so that we can test that in case there's a, in case our AJAX call fails or anything else like that. We can just reject on error and then it will do that. So we also have lifecycle methods that make it easy to set up and run tests. So that we don't have to repeat a lot of code. In here we have setup, before each, after each, and teardown. So in setup, this is where we can set up code that we want to run at the beginning of the whole test suite. This code needs to exist for the test suite to run. So we can put everything in there that we need to, so we don't have to duplicate it in each individual test. If we need code to reset itself before each test, we can do that with before each, and then clean up after itself with after each. So after each test suite, after each test in the suite, it'll run that, and then after, it'll run after each. And then finally, the teardown, so that we don't leave anything alive in the page or on the test. We can tear everything down so that we start from zero with the next test suite. So any questions real quick on unit testing? Okay.
How about functional testing?
Yeah.
Does the Intern work with Phantom.js?
Yes.
What's its preferred partners in Prime?
I'm about to cover it. Andy, did you have a question?
How do you use it, like, day-to-day?
Yeah. So I use it typically. I don't typically use the client to run the tests in Node because I'm more of a front-end developer. So I will have the page set up. I'm running it in Chrome, usually, since that's typically what I start development in. I'll run it in Chrome. I'll just have it set up with a grunt task that will reload the browser every time I save a test, and then it'll just reload in the background. I can see it turn red or green, and I'll just do that with Chrome. And then when I think it's ready and everything's passing in Chrome, then I'll go either manually test in other browsers, or I'll use functional testing to execute them in every browser that I need to ensure that everything is working everywhere. So functional testing, again, is where we programmatically mimic a user and then drive the page and assert that the actions to the page result in what we would expect. So all of these tests run in Node. We use the intern runner command for that. It sets up our client suite code, and then it executes each functional test. And each functional test, we define what browsers we want to test in, and or we can also define we want to test in Phantom or other places, headless browsers. And it'll kick off instances of those browsers. And then it will load up the client HTML page, execute the unit test in each one of those, and then it'll allow us to drive those pages so we can tell it to go get a resource, load it, click on a button, log in, do whatever we need to do, and then assert that those actions result in some kind of change to the page. So here's the flow of that. We write our functional tests. Again, Leadfoot is the wrapper around the WebDriver API, because the WebDriver API is not the best. It could be a lot better. Leadfoot tries to help with that quite a bit, and it also tries to smooth out inconsistencies between browser implementations so that you can have reliable tests running in any browser. But you use that, the primary thing that we'll use is the Leadfoot command object. So that's provided to us automatically with this.remote. We'll show some examples of that. But then that creates a new session, and then it talks over the JSON wire protocol to a WebDriver server that's running Chrome driver or IE driver, Firefox. And those will execute a browser, load the page up, and then deliver the results. It'll run the page and then deliver the results back to us. So we can test all of these browsers from the comfort of our command line. So again, Leadfoot is the WebDriver API. The WebDriver API itself is a low-level JSON protocol. It is being standardized by the W3C, and so it works with all of the major browsers, and there are some inconsistencies and bugs between them, but we try and smooth that out as much as possible. So again, the Leadfoot command object is the main object that we interact with from Leadfoot. We don't actually have to bring it in at all, it's just called remote, so we just say this.remote, and in this case, we're going to get this fixture.html page. We're going to load that up. You can see all of these calls are chainable. It kind of looks like jQuery methods. You just chain them all together. And all of them are asynchronous because we don't know how long it's going to take for the browser itself to go get that HTML page and then find an element on the page with an ID of operation and then click on it. And then we want to type in there hello world and then get its value. And we're going to, with the value, assert that the value equals hello world. So it equals what we actually typed in. And that's as simple as it is. We just chain these commands together and derive the browser. And this will work. We can load this code up in Firefox or Chrome or IE8, and it will just work. So with that, we can run our tests in a couple of different places. The easiest one, and the one that I use most frequently, is just locally. I'll just have Selenium running locally on my machine and execute it with the browsers that I have, because that's the fastest way. And then for the browsers that I don't have, I'll either have VMs set up with them, so I'll run them there, or I'll use something like BrowserStack or Sauce Labs, and it will automatically just connect to those, execute the test. It'll connect to Sauce Labs, create a VM, load the browser that we want to test, so it could be IE8 running on Windows XP, and then execute the test and deliver the results back to us. So here's an example of that. At SitePen, we primarily use Dojo, and Digit is the user interface library for Dojo. So this is an example using that. We've got a page. It's got a number of widgets that are created declaratively on the page. So we have a form object, and we have some radio buttons and a horizontal slider. And then this is the script tag inside of the page, and it just parses everything out. And then when it's parsed everything out of the browser, it sets this global variable ready equal to true. And that's important, and I'll show that on the next slide why it's important. But when we run it, we just get a page that looks like this. Over here, we've got a form. When we click on the form in here, we drop down, we've got a set of radio buttons and a slider, and we're going to test that if we actually took our mouse pointer, clicked on the slider, and dragged it all the way to the end, and then clicked one of the radio buttons, that the form object actually gives us back the value 100% for the slider and yes or no for the radio buttons. So that's just what we're going to test. We're going to actually drive this page and see that. So this is our test, our functional test. Again, we're just using define an AMD8 module. We bring in intern. We just write our tests like we did with the unit tests. We're registering a suite. And the thing that differentiates this from a unit test is that in here, we're actually going to use the remote object. That tells it that it's a functional test and will be executed like that. So we're going to get that page, the intern functional digit.html. And then we're setting some timeouts so that we set how long it should wait to look for elements on the page or timeout and all of that so that we don't have the test sitting and waiting forever. And then we're using this helper called pullUntil. And pullUntil is something that Leadfoot gives us here. So Leadfoot helper's pullUntil. We're just returning window.ready from there. So what this is going to do is it's going to take this string, convert it to JavaScript, and execute it on the page. And it's just going to sit there and constantly execute it on the page until it equals a non-null value. So on the previous slide, we set ready here, it's undefined, and then we set ready equal to true when everything is ready to go. So it will just sit there and wait until ready has been set to true, and then it will continue on. That way we know that the page is ready, everything has been brought in to the page that needs to be brought in, and it'll run as expected. And so then we can just get properties on the page. We'll get the title pane, we'll click on it so that we expand the form down. Then we'll sleep for 500 milliseconds. And then we'll get the yes button, the radio node, and we'll click on it. And then we'll get the horizontal slider, we'll get its size, and we will drag it. Here you can see that we get the horizontal slider's handle, and then with that, we move the mouse over to that handle, we press the mouse button down, we move it all the way to the end of the slider, and then release the mouse. And then we get the value of the form itself, and we just want to assert that the slider's value is 10 instead of 0 since we moved it all the way to the end, and that we clicked on the yes radio button and got that. And so I can actually run this test. Oops. So it would be... node modules, bin, intern, runner, and then I want to pass in the config, and it's slides, oops, testing in depth, and I forgot what this is in. And so if I run this, oh, of course, there, it kicked off a browser, and it's going to load the page up. And so everything, it's waiting, it's loading in everything that it needs. It clicked on that, moved the slider over, clicked the button, and then closed out. And you can see that it provided all of that down here. And it's actually also kicking off on my other screen, Firefox. No, and it just closed. But it ran Firefox and Chrome. I always have problems between the screens getting it to go on the right one. But it executed that in both browsers and then delivered the results right back to our lovely terminal. And we can see it even gave us code coverage. So we can see full code coverage analysis and then a breakdown of each file that was brought in and tested. So we can see that we tested, you know, 81% of the content pane resize mixing, et cetera. And so it's all right there in the terminal. So that's really nice, but it's difficult. There can be a lot of repetition with that, like always having to log into the page or doing that. So we recommend making page objects, and these are just objects that we can create that know how to interact with that page. And then we can just call those methods and pass in our remote object, and it will drive the browser for us and automatically log in or do whatever we need to do. So an example of that would be like if we had an index page. We just create a new constructor, and give it a login method. We pass in the username and password that we want to log in with, and this knows how to drive that page. So it'll find the login, click on it, type in its username, type in the password, click the login button, and then it will look for a login success element on the page, because that's what we determined to be successfully logged in, and then it just returns whether or not it was successful. So then we can use that easily, so we don't have to repeat that anyway. We can just create a new new index page object, and then just log in with test and test, and then once we log in, then we can make the assertions that we need to from there. So with that, let's look at configuring and running Intern. I've run Intern a few times, but I'll talk about it a little bit. First of all, the important thing with Intern is that it only works in ES5 environments, so that's IE9 and up. If you do want to test in IE8 or lower, you can. You just have to use a different version of Intern called Intern Geezer, and that allows it to run older versions of IE. It has a few different limitations, though. It's basically, you just have to basically say this.getRemote instead of this.remote. And then the only other thing is that the Chai assertion library is supported, has been ported over to work with that. But expect and should don't work because they're using getters and setters, and those are ES5 things only. So everything comes down to this configuration file that we create. This is just an AMD module again. We just define everything that we need in here. So we're telling it that we're going to use this version of Selenium. We list out all of the environments that we want to test here. So I said that I want to test IE11, IE version 11 on Windows 8.1, IE10 on Windows 8, Firefox 31 on OS X 10.9, Windows 7 and Linux, and Chrome, any version, the latest version on Linux, OS X, and Windows 7. We want to run a maximum of 3 tests at a time, and we want to use the Sauce Labs tunnel. That just means that it's going to automatically try and connect to Sauce Labs and run the test there. We can set that to null tunnel if we want to run it locally, as long as we have Selenium server running locally, or we can set it to browser stack or others. Then we define the tests that we have. So we have our unit tests that we define here. So we have test/hello, and then our functional tests, so test functional index. And then here, exclude instrumentation, I'll talk about that a little later, but it's just how we exclude things from code coverage. So maybe we don't want our tests or the node modules directory to be included in code coverage analysis, so we just exclude it with that regular expression there. You just install Intern from npm, npm install Intern, or npm install intern-geezer if you need the IE8 version. And then in the browser, you just load up the intern client.html from the node modules directory, and then give it a config to that, a path to that configuration file from the previous slide. And from node, we just do intern client and run it from there. So then we can run it from, if we want to run it on remote servers, we can do that with browser stack or sauce. We recommend just putting in the sauce username and access key as shell variables so that it will look for that there instead of actually putting them in your configuration, because they shouldn't be shared. Or you can just run it locally with Selenium server, have that installed from Homebrew or somewhere else, and then it will just pick up on that. So the one other thing that I wanted to show real quick before we run out of time is code coverage analysis. So we showed that it gives us this output here. We can also have it give us more detailed output in HTML, and we can have it plug into a number of other places as well. There's a number of reporters written for it. There's a console reporter, a JUnit reporter, TeamCity, Travis, Jenkins reporter, so that you can have this tied into your continuous integration environment, and it will just run. So we saw the HTML reporter. It looks like that. And then we can also run code coverage analysis. And with that, I will run the here. The other thing I wanted to mention real quick is that you just bring in Intern into your grunt file, and then you can set up a grunt task for everything. So in case you don't want to have to try and remember nodemodules.bin/intern-runner, it's a lot easier to just set up a grunt task for it. And so with that, I'll just run grunt intern coverage to create a code coverage report. And it ran, and then if I actually look at the files that it gave me this HTML report directory now. And so I can load that up
in my browser and go to the HTML report.
And it gives us full analysis of everything. So I can see that my app, I tested, it has 66.67% code coverage. And I can click on that and go in, and I can see that the hello.js file is what I've been testing. And I can click on that, and I can see, oh, those are the lines that I've tested, but I haven't tested this smile method here. So I know what I have to go in and test if I want to try and get my coverage up. And so, yeah, that's Intern. It's under a lot of development. We're constantly improving it in different ways. The latest release was this December, and we're continuing on adding new features, and we encourage you to contribute to it, try it out, and let us know what you think.
You have the word cucumber on your slide.
Yes.
All right.
It has.
I'm hungry to not talk to cucumber heads into wearing something.
I have not used cucumber yet, actually. But the examples that you've seen me running it all with Dojo, and I know that. How many of you use Dojo? All right. You should. It's awesome. Intern does work with anything. The tests are written as AMD modules to bring in everything. Those are run in Node. It uses Dojo to run those. It uses actually a pre-release of Dojo 2.0. That's what Intern is built on top of. But it runs with everything. So there's Angular, Backbone, all of those. And you can see examples of how to set it up for any project in the Intern examples repo. There's everything you need to know right there. Under the covers, it's just using Dojo 2.0. Chai for its assertions, Istanbul for code coverage, and then Leadfoot is the WebDriver API. DigDug is a tool that we developed that is just the wrapper around the tunnels, so the Sauce Labs tunnel, the Browser Stack tunnel, all of those. So there's a number of great tools, great companies using Intern. You know, there's Esri and Marriott, Mozilla uses it. There's a great talk actually from JQCon where they talk about how they use Intern. And then, again, it was started by Colin Snover at SitePen, and it's fully supported by us, freely available on GitHub. It's 100% open source, so check it out. That's where you can get involved. And also, theintern.io is probably the best place to get started. So, any questions? Yeah.
What are the competitors
with the Intern? Yeah.
There's actually a... I go to the intern.io. Oops. Maybe. We've got a full comparison of everything. So the main ones are, you know, Mocha is huge. Jasmine is really big for front-end development. And you can see all of the... everything that the Intern supports versus what the others support. So there's a lot more red. We might be a little biased, but there's a lot more red otherwise. Any other questions? Thank you.
Great job, Nick. Thank you so much.